I'll take three or four questions in a group, if I may. The first from the Lowy Institute in Australia, Michael Fuller-Love, your microphone is on.
Secretary Mattis, first of all, let me commend you, if I may, for taking on your current post with all its stresses and strains. For many of us, sir, you are the hope of the side. General, your speech focused on the rules-based regional order, which has been a preoccupation of this conference for many years, and I'd associate myself with your strong remarks. All of us here in Asia have the right to make our own way without coercion. And I'd like to thank you too for your comment on alliances. But I'd like to ask you about the rules-based global order, which you mentioned at the outset of your remarks, and in which President Trump appears to be an unbeliever. 70 years ago, Secretary Acheson wrote that he was present at the creation of a US-led order that has served all of us well. General, given everything over the past 4 months, including NATO and TPP and Paris, why should we not fret that we are present at the destruction of that order? Please give us cause for optimism, General.
I'll take three or more questions before I come back to the Secretary. The next, from Japan, Taro Kono.
Thank you. I'm Taro Kono, member of the Japanese Parliament. I have explained to my constituency that US-Japan alliance is not just about the security. It's alliance to share, promote the common values, such as democracy, human rights, freedom of press, free trade, environmental protection, and so forth. Today, more and more people are asking if this alliance is just about the security, not about the common values. The Secretary, what do you think? If it's alliance based on the common values, what are the common values we are trying to promote today? Thank you.
Two more questions before I go back to the Secretary. From China, Qiyu Chu.
Okay, thank you. General, I think I noticed that you mentioned strengthening the defense links between United States and Taiwan. And I think it is quite unusual for Secretary of Defense of the United States to say so in this occasion. And does it mean that there's some change with regard to the one China policy of the United States? Thank you.
And the final question in this round, Lin Kwok from Singapore, one of our young leaders.
Thank you very much for permitting me this question. I had actually two quick questions. My first one was, it relates to the statement made by your former NSC Senior Director for Asian Affairs, Dan Quintenbrick, on the day of the tribunal's ruling in the Philippines case against China. Now, he said that the United States has made clear that we have top national security interests in the, top national interests in the South China Sea, just as China does, and just as many other countries in the region do, and that the United States will not turn a blind eye to the waterway in exchange for cooperation elsewhere. Can we expect the same approach from the US, the current US administration? In other words, can we expect it not to sacrifice the South China Sea, in a sense, for cooperation, say, on North Korea? Now, my second question will be about your statement that the United States will not be accepting unilateral changes to the status quo. And in this respect, I presume you mean the island building and construction activities as well as militarization of features in the South China Sea. May I please know what the United States intends to approach this question? What are the specific acts that it intends to do to prevent this unilateral change in status quo? Thank you.
Well, you can always count on some straightforward questions here, can't you? as far as the rule-based order, you know, obviously we have a new president in Washington, D.C. We're all aware of that. And there's going to be fresh approaches taken. But just the fact that, just take a look at the president's first trip to the outside the United States was straight into the heart of one of the most bewildering and difficult challenges that the world faces in terms of how do we restore stability and peace, right? Into the Middle East, where the discussion was about how do we work together, in this case with the Arab League and with other international organizations, in order to reduce the threat of terrorism. So I think that we have been engaged in the world for a long time. I think historically the Americans have been reluctant to see themselves in that role. We were quite happy between our two oceans to stay there. The 20th century took us out of that. But at the same time, we recognized, especially the greatest generation, we call them, coming home from World War II, what a crummy world if we all retreat inside our own borders. How many people deprived of good lives during the Depression? How many tens of millions of people killed in World War II, like it or not, were part of the world? That carries through for all the frustrations that are felt in America right now, for the sense that at times we have carried an inordinate burden. That is still very deeply rooted in the American psyche, that engagement with the world. And I think that, to quote a British observer of us from some years ago, bear with us, once we've exhausted all possible alternatives, the Americans will do the right thing. So we will still be there, and we will be there with you. The fact that President Trump went to Brussels, he speaks with actions, too. He was there to show our statement that we are standing with the NATO allies 100%. He sent me on my first trip after I was nominated to Tokyo and Seoul in order to make certain there was no misunderstanding. Within weeks of him taking office, that we stood with the democracies of Japan and Korea. So we are there, and I can give you absolute optimism on this issue. I would just say about China, as we talk about, you know, whether or not there's any adjustment to one China. No, there is not. The policy remains. We believe in the peaceful resolution of the situation between China and Taiwan, and that's where we've stood for some years, and the One China policy holds. I would also say that in regards to China and whether or not the North Korea issue outweighs the South China Sea, this sort of thing, there's a lot more between the United States than just two issues. There are many areas, as I noted, of common interest, and certainly on terrorism, on nuclear proliferation. There are any number of issues where we have common ground with China. And to put it into a binary option of either we have to walk away from our values and what we stand for on freedom of navigation and all because we need to work with China on North Korea. We're working with China on North Korea, ladies and gentlemen, because that is also a problem with North Korea. For China. I do not choose to send THAAD to South Korea to protect the South Korean people from an imaginary problem. This is a real problem, and the problem is not South Korea putting a fully defensive system for the defense of their own people into position. The problem is North Korea, and if we want to stop the bringing more military capability into the Northwest Pacific, then we have to address the problem that is a threat to Japan, to South Korea, and all the other nations. So we have many areas that we can work with Korea, but at the same time, with China, but at the same time, Korea, North Korea is a problem that's got to be addressed, and we can do so. We believe that right now, China is working this issue. But I hope that addresses each of the four questions there, John.
Thank you very much. And I'll take a quick round. Please keep your questions crisp. From India, Parmendra Kumar Singh.
Secretary, I'm General P.K. Singh from India. We have been hearing, not just this session, but earlier years, we talk about rule-based laws being followed. But I don't think China is going to pull back its militarization from those islands, nor is North Korea going to denuclearize. So are we going to lay down a timeline, or are we going to keep repeating this over the years for the next decade or more? Thank you.
Thank you. I'll take three more. Richard Lloyd Parry from the UK.
Thank you, Dr. Chipman. Richard Lloyd Parry of The Times. Mr. Mattis, you made it clear that the US doesn't seek regime change in North Korea. So the very simple yes-no question is this. Does the North Korean government of Kim Jong-un have a right to exist?
From Singapore, Kishore Mabubani.
Thank you, Secretary Mattis, for your speech. You said that US-China competition will rise. It'll probably rise more acutely in the economic arena. China has launched the Belt and Road Initiative. United States has withdrawn from TPP. Is there any possibility at all of the United States reconsidering its decision to withdraw from TPP? Because that will be a powerful signal to this region.
And from Russia, Ekaterina Koldunova. Go ahead.
Yeah, thank you. Secretary Mattis, you mentioned rules-based order several times. My understanding is that it can be ensured only through the institutions. But at the same time, we have heard multiple questions about growing unilateralism in the US foreign policy. I will not repeat them. And my question is, what will be the role and function of the regional security institutions if this tendency really exists and will go on? And how could we ensure the ASEAN centrality, for example, in these settings? Thank you.
And the final question from Australia, Christopher Roberts.
Thank you. I'm from UNSW at the Australian Defence Force Academy. Some might argue that China has already largely achieved its goals in the South China Sea. Given my own discussions in Manila and beyond, US relations with President Duterte and President Duterte's stand over the South China Sea might be improved if the US provides a continuous security presence around features such as the Scarborough Shoal, perhaps even via a coalition of coast guards, including Australia, and an unconditional guarantee to protect the legally declared EEZ of the Philippines. Can the US take such steps, in addition to what you have already indicated, to put an immediate halt to the expansion of China's presence within the EEZ of the Philippines? And could something similar be done in the case of Vietnam and perhaps Malaysia? Thank you.
Yeah, there's a little bit of an echo up here, so we're working together to make sure I've got the right questions here, ladies and gentlemen. On the rules-based order, we have enduring interests. And I think that when you look at those enduring interests, you find the enduring motivations to reinforce and hold fast with the rules-based approach. I don't think that this is something new. I think it is as old as history, and the fight between those who want a rules-based order and those who try through coercion to find ways around it, frankly, and it's simply something we have to work together on. I think that one point I would make is that we have got plenty of valid reasons for many nations to work together in maintaining the rules-based order today. These are valid because we can quantitatively show the value in commerce and in security where we work together. As far as on the ASEAN centrality, I think that we need organizations that allow people to come together to discuss common problems, and I think that ASEAN provides that forum. where ASEAN goes. These are sovereign nations. They have to work together, and we respect that. We're happy to be linked to ASEAN and in our status that we maintain, the relationship we maintain, and support it. But in the economic arena especially, I think ASEAN will play a role as we look at how do we have not just free trade, but we have fair trade among all the nations involved there. And I think on how do we, let me jump over here to South China Sea. Ladies and gentlemen, we're going to have to work together on this. I don't think there's room right now to get into pushing adversarial approaches. What we have to do is take into account, number one, what each nation's interests are there in the South China Sea, and then we have to have mediation capability in order to ensure that small nations, large nations, all nations can work them out to mutual satisfaction, because that's the only way we will have an enduring solution. One size doesn't fit all in the sense of one nation imposing its will there. Did I miss any of them there? What about yeah, and on the TPP situation, ladies and gentlemen, it's going to be a fresh approach. Obviously, there were many disappointed about the TPP decision, but at the same time, it only directs us to bilateral approaches and other multilateral approaches that we will engage in. I have no doubt that we will stay engaged on those. It means one avenue did not meet our nation's population's desires, but it doesn't mean we're turning our back on relations that we would work out on a bilateral basis as a result.
Sure. We can take one, maybe two questions if they're very brief. General Yao from China, but brief.
Thank you, Dr. Chipman. Just one specific question, because we are talking about rule-based international order, regional order. I'm curious to know what international rules are the freedom of navigation operations based by the United States. What kind of rules should be applied here? Because to my understanding that about 50 countries in the world have made national laws asking for prior notification or consent when foreign military ships enters their territory waters. But the U.S. has been conducting freedom of navigation operations to challenge this kind of excessive maritime rights since 1979. And United States is not even a party member to the UN Law of the Sea, Convention of Law of the Seas. So what should we take as rules in relating to this kind of military operations, the so-called freedom of navigation operations? Because this, for the last 3 years, the U.S. Navy has been challenging China, Vietnam, the Philippines, Malaysia, Indonesia, also including Japan, India, by conducting freedom of navigations. It's not only against China. I'm just curious to know what are the rules.
Well, yeah, thank you very much. And I'll take one more. Hiroyuku Akita from Japan.
Thank you very much. My question is about North Korea. You said that if there is a war in North Korea, there's going to be a tragic, tragic on unbelievable scale. So my question is, do you think that the U.S. will act if necessary, preemptively, militarily, without give warning to the foreigners living in South Korea? Because it is said that there's going to be several hundred thousand foreigner, including American citizen, living in Korean Peninsula. So I wonder if option could be to act preemptively without pre-warning if necessary, to those people to evacuate. Thank you.
Thank you very much. So I'll have the Secretary answer those two questions, and then we'll close the session. Mr. Secretary.
Right. We have the law of the sea. I recognize your question, General, but the law of the sea is not the only law that we go by in the sea, that one act. I would just tell you that there's a tradition in the sea. There's traditional areas of the sea that have been used as international waters since time began. And we believe that those kinds of standards should be maintained. They should not be unilaterally changed. No matter what one nation's interests are, we have to work together if we're going to have the freedom of commerce that all nations can benefit from. As far as about having any warning or you know, how we address North Korea. Right now, we are doing our best through the United Nations, through engaging with Beijing's good offices, working with the international community, obviously working with the Republic of South Korea, Japan. We are working diplomatically, economically. We are trying to exhaust all possible alternatives to avert this race for a nuclear weapon. In violation, to go back to an earlier question, in violation of the United Nations restrictions on North Korea's activities. We've also seen North Korea engaged in proliferation activities, which means those nuclear capabilities are not solely being retained by North Korea in their own defense. They are actually exporting some of that capability, some of that knowledge. And so, to us, we want to stop this. We consider it urgent, but at the same time, we are working right now diplomatically and economically, and we obviously work very, very closely with the United Nations command. This is not just an American command here, a United Nations command, and the sending nations being those that sent troops under the UN Security Council resolution in 1950. Because that war was never ended, those nations are still committed to maintaining the peace on the peninsula. And so we work obviously with them as well in terms of the military options. Right now we are doing our very best to exhaust all economic and diplomatic initiatives to get this under control.
Mr. Secretary, thank you very much.